Hey guys, it's Big Mike, and like always, I'd like to thank you for being here today. Today we've got Rob Mitchell here to talk about auction market theory and trading with value. Rob's been trading for about 30 years. He is a trader that relies on volume analysis to pinpoint support and resistance and key areas to trade from in the market. He has won the World Cup Advisor Trading Championship, and he created his own CTA group, Creative Capital Management, back in April 99. The topics for today include auction market theory, just a general overview and discussion, specifically how to determine value from the marketplace, and understanding market context, understanding what these support and resistance lines mean when viewed in context, and also creating a daily trading plan to trade from. Matt from Optimus Futures is also here today, and it's because of Matt that we have been introduced to Rob Mitchell. So before we get started with Rob, I'm going to very briefly turn things over to Matt at Optimus Futures. He's going to give you a quick overview of what services Optimus provides and answer any questions that you have from Optimus, and then we'll turn things over to Rob. As you guys have questions, type them into the questions box. We'll do our best to get everyone's questions answered today. And I will also post the recording for this webinar on the site sometime tomorrow. Thanks, guys. Give me 1 second, and I'll turn things over to Matt.
Can I have an indication if you guys can hear me?
We can hear you, and we see your Internet Explorer window.
Okay. All right, so I'll just open the main thing. This is our main screen, so everybody will just focus on that. Mike, thank you for bringing me here. And I just want to thank everybody on the forum. I enjoy interacting with you, and I always thank Mike for running one of the most courteous and most informative forums out there. I mean, I'm just astonished that I've seen forums over the years. I've never seen anything that grew like that, and such friendship has developed between people, forums, and traders really and sincerely trying to help one another. I wanted to bring you Rob today before I talk about Rhythmic. Rob is one of my dearest friends in this industry. Had a lot of influence in the way I think, and believe it or not, had a lot of influence in the way also run my brokerage and the philosophy that I have behind this brokerage as far as margins and commissions, and how we treat people and so forth. And talking to him about markets is probably one of the more intelligent conversations that I have out there with third-party vendors. So you'll enjoy him very much. Just to tell you a little bit about Optimus Trading Group, we're basically a discount brokerage firm. This is where a majority of our business goes. Probably 80%. The rest, we also execute systems for people. We execute commodity trading advisors, business here as well. People who are have shown that they have a track record and so forth. They use our execution services. It's Optimus because we have a very good and organized back office. Stay with me 1 second. I'm just going to disable everything here. Sorry about that. The main solution that we use for our platforms is Rhythmic. And we just found it to be the best solution for us. As you guys know, always respect whatever other people are using. We right now just have hooked up every single platform to it. NinjaTrader, MultiCharts, Trade Navigator, Market Delta, RT Investor, and so forth. So the vision I see for Optimus Trading Group in the future is really to facilitate and help people on the technology side to get better execution, better pricing, better handle on trading. One of the things that we have started is also a hosting solution, getting closer to the exchange, as you see here, the third service that we have here, right around here. And basically, because I just want to help people get better execution if they're in a remote location, just to show you part of the philosophy of Optimus Trading Group. In the future, we'll be focusing on probably mobile applications. be focusing on additional technologies and other services that will help people with risk management. Obviously, I can't disclose everything. This is a recorded webinar. There's competitors out there, so we're trying to keep a niche. But basically, that's where I see the vision is. The vision is not to have another salespeople to sit on the phone and yell all day, but really rather work with vendors out there who are good in technology. And I think the word has spread. I think on the discount side, I'll be very honest with you, I was probably one of the last brokers to get into the whole platform thing and everything else. But because of Rhythmic, we were able to gain a lot of customers who have recognized, you know, the quality of the feed, the quality of the technology, the services, and so forth. That's basically it. If you have any questions, please go ahead and answer me. I just want to allow a little more time for Rob to talk, to educate you on this business, but of course, I'll answer anything.
Okay, thanks, Matt. So if anybody has questions about Optimus Futures, if you have questions about what they offer, what platforms they support, how to get started, go ahead and ask them now. And Matt, I don't think you mentioned Sierra Chart, but it does work with Sierra, right?
Yeah, correct. I'm sorry if I forgot. Yes, we do. We work with the main platform that everybody knows is Sierra Charts, MultiCharts, NinjaTrader. We work with Rhythmic's platform, which is RTrader and RTrader Pro. Recently, we have hooked up with Trade Navigator, RT Investor, and Market Delta. So basically all the big ones out there. And we are bringing more platforms that we'll definitely work with, even okay. If there are smaller ones out there.
Okay. And how can someone get a hold of you? Do you want to list an email address, or should they just use the website?
Absolutely. If somebody wants to get a hold of me, it's a simple email. It's, you know, I'll write it down here. It's matt@optimusfutures.com. And you can always call me and ask me anything that you want directly about platforms, commissions, in lieu of the recent events in the industry with companies and compliance and so forth. I can address that here as well.
So Kelly wants to know if you support TradeStation. Maybe you can answer how that works.
We don't support directly TradeStation customers. What we have a professional license vendor through TradeStation. So if people want, for example, have automated services, we can execute it on our platforms. For example, we hooked up NinjaTrader to TradeStation. So basically, we can take an algorithm from somebody in easy language, run it for them, and execute it over here. We don't support the platform directly. Naturally, TradeStation is our competitor, and they have their own technology and their own brokerage. Alternatively, yeah. There were some customers that – sorry, go ahead.
I was going to just say, for those that don't know, TradeStation is a closed system. They, you know, they're their own broker. That's all you get.
Correct. For some other customers who wanted to use our services, you know, some people we have helped them translate their codes in easy language from easy language to power language with MultiCharts to run it through Rhythmic. So that's a possibility as
right.
well.
Okay, and then I see one more question, and then we can turn things over to Rob. The question is, what controls does Optimus Futures have in place to prevent what happened with PFG from occurring within your brokerage? That's a hot topic, so I'll give you a second to answer that.
I understand. I've actually, in the last week has been really, really difficult, a very emotionally draining period for me, not because I had any ties to PFG, because it was just simply hard to talk to all the customers that had money over there, and customers had a lot of money. People sent them a lot of money, and they trusted them, and because it was supposedly the family that owned the business was were in the farming business for many years, and you know, farmers have a lot of trust between them, so a lot of people trusted them, and I would say a lot more with their risk capital that you should put in futures. I think they had a lot more in them. So for many people, it was very devastating. So I'm fully aware of it. Ourselves, you know, we were a guaranteed IB of Vision Financial Markets. I used to work for Vision Financial Markets, and I trust the people over there. I have a very simple perspective on this thing. Businesses, you know, can go, I mean, businesses can fail. If you have more money going out than money coming in, businesses fail. It takes a totally separate mentality to tap into customers' funds. So I, after working all those years with Vision, and I've been working with them since my early 20s, I just refuse to believe that they're the kind of people who would do that. I know everybody, I worked right beside the ownership, I worked with compliance, worked with everybody else there, and I've seen what they've done when times are tough. And what they do is basically they tighten their belt a little bit and they say, you know what, look, you know, we can't do this and we can't do that. And I've seen them go through ups and downs. So that's one thing. They have a very strong compliance. They're exchange members. They're NFIM members, CFTC. And basically, that's the only thing I can tell customers, you know, so far, legally speaking. I think what you have to do, and this is something that's not available to customers, and this is something that I look at, you know, when you choose your clearing firm, and again, I respect every decision you make out there, every broker or the FCM that you're with and so forth. So I'm talking specifically about me and how I make my decisions. You know, I don't do business with companies. I do business with people. I avoided REFCO, I avoided MF Global, and I avoided PFG. And I went through all the scandals. So I was solicited by just everybody in the industry. What I like to know is the owners of the FCM, how they behave, if they're responsible, how fiscally they behave towards risk, how they assess risk, do they have proprietary trading, do they try to run a lot of businesses outside of the FCM that that could have impact. And in general, believe it or not, I look at the lifestyle that they have. So this is the one thing that it's important to me as far as the individuals that I do business with. I think personality plays a big role in who you choose to do business with. And Mike, to be honest with you, your forum is great for that because, you know, there's enough information there for people to really make decisions of who is behind the scenes of those companies. It's pretty transparent and people discuss it and they share the information out there. So that's the one thing I would do, you know, not just look at CFTC and NFA records, but really look behind the scenes who's running those companies. They have prop desks, their personalities, how long they've been in business and so forth.
Right.
So it's
okay. Thank you.
In a nutshell, that's
right. Thank you for that. So if anybody has any further questions for Matt, then the website is optimistfutures.com and you can send him an email at matt@optimistfutures.com. All right. So thanks, Matt. We'll let you go.
Thank you. I can see your phone's
literally ringing off the hook. So give me one second.
Thank God it does.
Give me a second. I'll turn things over to Rob. Hang on, guys. All right, Rob, you should be on. You should see the option to share your screen.
I think I do here. You guys can hear me all right?
Yes.
Okay. Okay, thanks. Thanks, everybody, for going through that with us. We had a little miscomputation. I have a lot of monitors here, and they're in vertical configuration. So thanks for bearing with us on that. Mike, thanks very much for the introduction. And Matt, thank you also, and thank you for inviting me to speak today. I kind of was holding myself back from saying some things about Matt. Matt and I, as he said, have known each other for many years, and Matt's just a really good guy. I can sum it up that way, and he works for a very, what I see to be a very solid firm as well. So without further delay, let's get into the presentation because I have a lot to talk about, a lot of slides to cover. And we'll have a Q&A session at the end. And so if you have any questions for me, fire away at the end. But I'll try and get through this quickly so we have plenty of time for that. Before going any further, the CFTC disclaimer, past performance is not necessarily indicative of future results. There's a risk of loss trading futures. That means you can lose more than you have in your account, and you need to be aware of those things when you open an account. So. One thing that I always like to talk up front, it's probably an over-discussed subject, but is trader psychology. And I bring this up at first because it's at the core of what I believe is an effective approach to trading. and I hit it maybe a little differently than other people might talk about, but if you learn from people who are great in sports or acting, for example, you'll find that they practice their craft to the point that they can do it without having any rational thought. And the idea is to get that rational mind out of the way. And, you know, when you put a 70-millimeter camera 6 inches from somebody's face, and if even the slightest little twitch or flinch in their eye just totally gives them away, or many of us are more familiar with sports. You know, if you're playing basketball and you have any doubt as you, you know, go to make that layup, you know, you're probably going to fumble it somehow. And so, because the rational mind comes in and starts analyzing things, and it's very paralyzing for many people. And so to trade successfully as a discretionary trader, not as somebody who's firing through TradeStation, as Mike and Matt were just discussing, to a FCM. But if you are trading on a discretionary basis throughout the day, and that's pretty much what we're going to be talking about today, then you're really in a much better position to get that rational thinking out of your way. And the way that you do this is you become so familiar with what it is you are doing that you can kind of throw it in the trash and let yourself just act naturally, and so and intuitively. And so I'm a musician. I studied bass for many years, and I've been a classical guitar player, and a teacher that I have right now told me about a theory of learning, and he said that when you're under stress, you always reduce to first learn behaviors. And what this means is that if you learn, in the case of music, if you learn to play that piece of music incorrectly from the beginning, you don't practice it in time, and you approach it in a sloppy manner, then when you come under stress, when you walk out on that stage and you look out there and there's 3,000 people out there, you will naturally reduce to your first learned behavior, which is the bad way of playing it. You learned it wrong in the first place, and then you overcame that and relearned it correctly. And then when you walk out on the stage, you go all the way back to the learning it wrong. And that's why I bring this up. If you can learn things right from the beginning and approach everything correctly from the beginning, then it frees you to be much stronger when you come under stress. Because the second you click that button, you know, you're not on a sim trader. You're really dealing with a whole different animal. And so you may be able to behave one way while you're sim trading, and then as soon as you have $500 on the line or $750 or whatever it might be today for the lots you're trading and the stops you're using, you suddenly are back to some really bad habit. And so it's important to learn things right from the beginning. And so I try to approach things structurally as we go through this webinar that will be that. What I believe is that structure that can give you the foundation in terms of market auction theory. So I like to talk about a story about an art auction. And I believe in one of James Dalton books. James Dalton are probably some of the best books on this subject. But I believe the second one, Markets in Profile, he talked about this briefly, but it's a very instructive point of looking at just exactly what is the market doing as it's going up and down and alternating during the day. And essentially what you have is an auction, but it's a continuous auction. So we can simplify that idea a little bit by talking simply about like an art auction for, let's say, just a painting. And let's say you have this painting for sale, and it's a very famous painting or something, and you have 50 people come into the auction. And the reason these 50 people showed up at the auction is because they believed that the opening bid for that was a fair price or a good deal, probably more likely a good deal. And so what happens is they open bidding, say, at $100, and then at that point in time, everybody in the room agrees that it's worth $100, and the auctioneer then says, do I hear 110? And someone raises their hand, yes, I'll pay 110 for that. And then, you know, it goes up a little more, and next thing you know, you're at 130. And at which point, certain people in this group of 50 people, this closed audience of 50 people, start saying, well, I'm not paying $130 for that thing. I mean, I came in here thinking if I could get it for 120, that would be pretty good. And so what happens is, you know, three or four people now drop off. They're no longer going to participate. They've decided it's not worth it. And then up it goes a little more, higher and higher, 150, 180, 200, you know, who knows, sky's the limit. And then something amazing happens. There's one person remaining in the room who wins the auction. And at that point in time, what is happening is there is 49 people in the room that think that the price is absolutely absurd. And there is one person in the room who bought it and is probably having some kind of buyer's remorse at that point. Oh my goodness, what did I do here? I just paid, you know, all this money for this painting. And, you know, I mean, the other people in the room might even be chuckling, what an idiot, you know. And so in the market, that would correspond with the high or the low of the day. In the market, that auction can go down. That would be a reverse auction where you'd start it at, say, $100 and work it all the way down to $10 because nobody was interested in it at the initial bid of $100. And so there's a continual evolving auction when we start doing this in the S&P or the Russell or whatever market we might do. So when that last person makes that purchase out of the 50, the one out of the 50, there's officially at that point 98% of the population there agrees that the painting is not worth what it sold for. And so this inspires a couple of interesting things. If you know that you can sell, let's say that the painting that is selling in this auction is duplicable, then what would happen is those with a little bit of ingenuity would start thinking, well, you know, if people will pay that crazy amount for that painting, then I'm going to set up shop and go in business for myself, and I'm going to sell these things. I'm going to open up a art gallery, and I'm going to sell these things if people are willing to pay that kind of money. Now, of course, we're out in the extreme of a curve here, and so it's really not worth that amount, but there are cases where we see, you know, a real estate bubble. We all went through this. That we know that prices will just continue climbing without any rational thing, and it's usually driven by some other thing like a lot of available money or something of this nature. Anyways, I just wanted to open up this idea about what an auction really is and what kinds of psychology and statistics are behind this. And because auction theory is really nothing more than what you learn in a statistics 101 course. It's really looking at price distributions and probabilities within those distributions. And typically these things are shown on a screen, and I will go to this next slide and we'll talk about what these things look like on a screen for those who might not know. There's a couple of ways that you can look at them. And the one I'm going to focus on today is volume at price. And what this means is for any given tick, the S&P there's 4 ticks per point, and the Russell there's 10 ticks per point. For each one of those ticks, what we're going to do is over a given period of time looking back, we're going to accumulate the ticks for each one of those prices, the volume at each one of those prices. So in the case of our art auction, that very top high that the painting sold for, there's a one lot that that ultimately sold at that price. What will happen is as you move back towards the price where people might have had more agreement as to what the value was, that it was trading at a fair value, then at that point there will be more volume at that point. And what you end up with on many days, and today is an example of this, is you end up with what's called a bell curve distribution. And so that is where the high and low of the day have low volume, and then the price of the day closes somewhere in the central part of that range between that high and the low. and the distribution is curved around that. It's evenly distributed around that point. And when you get this kind of a distribution, what it means is that there's agreement about the pricing at that central tendency. And that would be called an average price. And so what happens is, because that volume is very high in the center of that curve, that means the majority of it agrees on that pricing, and that is what we call value. There's a difference between the value and the pricing that occurs. And the example of that is anybody who goes out to shop a deal, there's a difference between value and price. The price is what it's being advertised for. Price is simply an advertisement. And in auction theory, we say that price moves lower in search of buyers, and it moves higher in search of sellers. And so the actual value is what the collective population who may be participating in that price believe is a fair value, whereas the price is what it's selling at or trading at right now. And so this auction theory, this use of statistics to analyze where the price is trading in time, enables us to establish where the majority of participants likely see as a fair pricing right now in the very recent past. And so once we have that all figured out, then we don't really have it, it's not mysterious any longer. We now understand we're just dealing with a distribution. And I think if I can pull this up on the screen, I'll just draw this. Okay, I guess it won't. I don't know how to draw this, but if I just simply show, let's say this day 7/11 right here, because I don't have today's on.
Rob, you can draw if you want. On the left of the GoToWebinar, there's little icons. The bottom icon is drawing tools. You can use that if you want.
Let's see. On the bottom left.
This little bitty icons that are off to the side of the panel. And the bottom one is drawing tools.
Oh, cool. Okay. Yeah, thank you. Okay, I'm just going to draw right on here. And so if we have, can you guys see that all right?
Yes.
See my funny little drawing up there? Can you guys see that? Okay. If this is the price region that we're talking about, if I look at this bottom little pivot right here, that's going to be a very, if I just draw a box around this, and I'm going to analyze the volume inside this. What I know is that down at this low one, I just have one, one unit of volume right there. And as I go higher, I'm going to pick up two because I've got the V right there. And so I'll have a little bit more volume. And then as I get up to here, I'm going to start picking up this point, this V, so I'll have 3 points of volume. And then as I get here, I'm going to have four, one, two, three, four going across. I'm going to have another one there. And then as I get up in here, I'm going to end up having the volume's going to kind of be like this. And because this has all this volume up on top, I'm going to end up with a distribution that's kind of like this. And so it's going to be kind of a somewhat of a P-shaped. And we'll talk about the shapes in a little bit. But that's essentially what it's doing, is just plotting the volume at each one of these ticks throughout this this period of time that I have on there. And so there are several different shapes that you get. Now I'm going to go over those with you. I'm going to go over those with you in a little while. So let's continue on to our next slide. If I can figure out how to turn the, here we go. Let me see if now I got to figure out how to turn it back off.
Does escape work?
Mike, let me try escape. All right, thanks for bearing with me on the newbie on the Citrix system. Okay, here we go, guys. We'll get to this next slide. So what we have here is a distribution like what I've been talking about over the past several minutes over each day. And so what it's doing is inside of each one of these days, it's drawing the distribution price volume at price for each one of these. And then these upper and lower bands that we have on here are the what are called the value area high and the value area low. And I think I'm going to get to that in a minute. So let's get to areas of interest in terms. What the volume profile in the chart is doing is it's taking a statistical viewpoint of price distribution. And then the dashed cyan lines above and the dashed coral lines below and the value area high and low are called VAH and VAL respectively. These are terms you will commonly see with people who do this kind of analysis, value area low, value area high, and point of control. We'll get to that in a minute. But these levels on these particular charts, the way I have them set up, is to contain 70% of all trading that occurred. Now, this 70% level, you'd also learn this in a Statistics 101 course, is, well, 66% is one standard deviation contains about 67% or so of all cases. And then if, as you go out to the higher part of that distribution I drew on there a minute ago, you get into the second standard deviation. That holds another, I think, 30% or so. And then the last one is about 90% of all the cases for that particular distribution. So if we go to this, there are coral lines below, coral below, and blue above. And what that's showing is the price, the value area for this particular day for the 17th, these two right here. And then this line in the middle is the point of control. And the point of control is where the most volume was for that day. Sometimes you'll see point of control called the POC. And so that is considered to be fair value for that particular day, that point of control. And the zone in between is considered to be the value area. And so I'll get into more in a minute on how we use this. In between the value area high and value area low is another line called the point of control. And the point of control is the level at which the most trading took place on a chart for the relevant interval. And in most cases, the POC is an area where there is or has been some agreement about pricing. And this may also be called a high volume node, HVN. And which just means that's the highest point. There are also areas of low volume, and these are areas where there is no consensus about pricing. And this may be called a low volume node. Let's see if, we'll get to the low volume and high volume nodes in a little bit, because this is really, this concept here, high volume and low volume, is really the key of what I want to show you today in this presentation, because it's really everything. But we'll get to that in a minute. Prices tend to move between areas of high volume agreement and low volume disagreement. Again, I'll reiterate, the high volume was where the majority of that art auction crowd agreed that pricing was fair, and that represents value. And so that's the high volume. The low volume, where that last guy traded, the high of the day, that represents disagreement. Prices will tend to move with little resistance through areas of low volume and with resistance in areas of high volume. This is a very important concept because it can tell you if a breakout is valid or not. If I have a breakout setting up on a chart and I know on my profile that there's nothing but low volume behind it, then I know that price can very freely and very quickly move through that region. And so I will try to trade in areas of breakouts into low volume because I want that price to move like crazy away from my entry. And so we'll get into more detail about this as we go forward. I want to continue. And I don't want to get too far behind the curve here on the timing. So. Auction price movement. In areas of high volume, prices will tend to congest or consolidate. And we can make predictions about price action based on the analysis of these areas. Let's take a look. Here we have a composite, and this is actually very close to what I have on my screen today, but it's changed a little bit. But what we have here essentially is, if I look at this, we came up into this high volume. We're up in this high volume node right here. And then note what we did through this low volume region right here. We gap, boom. So overnight, it just, and then it opens up in higher volume. So it goes from high volume, just overnight, boom, right there. You can see this high bump here. And then it drifts around in this high volume area, because high volume is a price attractor. And then we come into this next day, and we start seeking value elsewhere. We probably had a report on this day. I don't remember that far back. And what do? We seek through, and we find almost the very lowest volume area on the whole volume chart here. We come down into here, the lowest volume area. And then we come back up, and we seek back into high value again. And so this is the principle, is that you move towards high volume, and you tend to get rejection in low volume where there is not agreement about price. What makes markets consolidate or trend? When a market is in consolidation or high volume, it's in agreement about valuation and is often waiting for new information before shifting modes. When a market is in a trend, there is not agreement about valuation, so it seeks new pricing and new value. And so discerning these environments is a big part for me of trading profitably, is discerning where these volume areas are and what the market is likely to do as it enters into these areas or is rejected by these areas. Rejected or accepted, depending on high or low volume. And for this reason, I, 35 years ago, 40 years ago, I was in real estate. They said, location, location, location. You're going to be a real estate investor. Location, location, location. And so I say for trading, context, context, context. It's the same thing. When we can establish the context of the market, we know if it's likely to trend or move to new areas. And we can then turn this into an actionable plan. And this is kind of, I always want to know the context I'm trading in advance. So as the day unfolds, I know already, because I've already done the homework, I already know what is likely in the play. And I noticed that Mike, at the beginning of this presentation, it was very appropriate. He had a dollar sign on the front of the presentation. That wasn't part of my PowerPoint presentation, which looks really boring, but he had this really nice looking graphic on there. It was a dollar sign that was cut into a puzzle. And trading is very much like this. It's like solving a puzzle. And so when you know where these areas of high and low volume are and what the price action is doing, and then you can see the news reports, whether or not they're meeting or beating expectations, you can often paint a very clear picture of what is likely to happen. And then it's just a matter of getting a position on with a manageable stop for the reward you think you might be working with. And so price versus value, what's the most important price of the day? I always like to ask this. And the answer is the open. The first question I'm asking myself each morning when I come in the office is, are we opening in or out of value? I do I have a little YouTube channel that I started where I discuss the overnight price action, and I talk about where we are with respect to this whole value equation. And that's actually what I'm trying to do with this presentation, is to teach you so you can do this yourself. And actually, the YouTube channel was intended to do that too, to teach how to do this overnight analysis with respect to these volume areas. And we'll get into that a little bit more. The simplest form of value analysis occurs at the open, because you can easily tell if there's a change in sentiment or value. And so if we're gapping away, there's obviously been some sort of change overnight in the perceived value, because we have moved away from volume. And similarly, we could be opening inside range like we did this morning, and then you get a range trading day. We'll talk about that in a minute. value rules. If the market opens inside value, there is agreement about pricing and the market is more likely to range. And like I said, that's exactly what happened this morning. If the market opens above value, it is bullish, and I will look to buy retracements lower. So if it comes down lower, I'm going to look to buy. Because the market opened above value, it told me that there's a change in perceived value, and if it retraces a little bit, I'll try and find a low-risk entry in that. The ones I'm giving you here are textbook kinds of strategies. I'm giving you the basics, and of course there's failures and, you know, anything can happen, but this is the basic context that you impose, because when you create a context, you have now a basis for learning. If you don't really have a context, you're just kind of out there in no man's land, and that's really the biggest single reason that I do this sort of analysis every single day, is because it gives me a context from which to learn more about the market. And so, continuing, if the market opens below value, it is bearish and I will look to sell retracements. And if the market opens outside of yesterday's range, higher or lower, it's out of value, out of range, this is even stronger. This slide right here, excuse me, is the very core of I call it the daily value report and value area report. And it's this slide right here is the very structure of that. And I will show you where you can view that each day in a little while. It's just something I put out on the internet. Buy sell areas. If we open above value, then look to buy the value area high or the point of control. So this is the retracement. So instead of using something like a moving average or something, I'm going to buy at a return to value. If we open above value, I'm going to try to buy at a return to value. Either a return to the highest level of reasonable value, the value area high, or the point of control, which is the most agreed upon area of value. If we open below value, then look to sell the value area low or the point of control. So we're below it. I'm going to look to sell the most likely agreed upon value from the previous day, or the lesser of that, the value area low. But I'm going to look for it to touch that value area. And then within that larger context of that trading plan that I'm presenting on these last two slides, I want to know exactly what's going on with the news. I don't necessarily need to know what the news was, but knowing the time that the news is coming out and seeing the reaction to it within this framework of this larger context of the value area. And so I'll get to that. Hopefully we'll have a little bit of time at the end of the presentation, and I will talk about the recent price action today and yesterday, for example, if we have time. Here's a slide. Sometimes I forget how I made these, but essentially what we had here on this day, this is the value area from that previous day. Notice that day was very narrow, a very narrow, 2 days in a row, a very narrow price action. That was the fourth, so that gave you a really narrow one. But you have a very narrow value area here, and then what happens is the price departs away from it and trades lower. This is a textbook kind of a scenario. On this particular day, it looks like we opened in value, and then we did a strange thing. We just ranged back and forth all day, and although we did it outside of value, but it was a very tight range. We've had very tight ranges lately, it's made trading difficult. Let me see if I have another one here. Here's another one where you open below value and you just head south all day. This one you open in value. Typically you would range inside of a day like that, inside of the value area. But very often later in the afternoon you'll break a little lower. Here's a day where you open in value and you just range all day. This one you open below and it ranges. Sometimes when you gap, you just don't have the gusto. It gaps below value, below range, and you get some downside, and then it just decides to sit sideways all day. So you have to deal with each one of these cases because it doesn't always do what it's supposed to do. And so that's why you kind of watch what's going on and try to bring other information into this contextual equation that we've been talking about. On a more advanced basis, volume profile value analysis can get much more advanced. Let's look at a couple other forms of analysis. Shapes. I always like to think of myself, years and years ago, I owned a restaurant, and I studied with a French chef, and when I finally couldn't afford to work for him anymore, I opened my own restaurant, and I took all of this high-end French style cuisine, and I reduced all of it to a process. It was kind of like McDonald's. That's what they've done. They've reduced everything they do down to the simplest steps so that they can show anybody how to do it. And it's duplicable anywhere. You have McDonald's opening all over Asia right now, for example. Very successful. Don't get me talking about McDonald's. They've paid a dividend for, I think, 34 years. Every year they raise their dividend for 34 years. I always reduce the theory to a simple to understand concept. And when you're able to get through the logic, this also happens when you write computer programs for trading things. You have to get down to the very specific logic that's making it work. And then you know when it's doing it or not doing it because you know the specific rules. It's not a fuzzy kind of idea in there. And so I had mentioned earlier there's a lot of cultism to auction theory circles. And like I said, it's really just statistics 101 applied to markets. And so they'll go on and on and on about it, and you read a 500-page book, and you know you can really be reduced to a couple of sentences. So that's kind of what I'm trying to do for you here, I'm just reducing these things down to the simplest terms. And that's where we get into the shapes here. There are four basic shapes that you can have in a profile. Of course, you could come up with more of them if you want to because it's, you know, it's kind of continuous function. Some days it's kind of fuzzy what the shapes are. But by and large, there are four basic shapes. You have a capital D, a little B, a P, and a big B. A D shape is what I was talking about in the beginning. We talked about a bell curve distribution. It's a normal statistical distribution when you have that, and it's evenly distributed. And I think, you know, if I go back a couple of slides, you know, that was this day here. For example, would have been, the 5th, or this day the 6th. Those are normal distributions. It's just D-shaped. And so the next shape, let's see what else I had here. D-shapes are associated with consolidation and the building of value in a region on your chart. Breakouts occur from Ds. Now, the reason that breakouts occur from Ds, Ds represent value, highly agreed upon value. And so usually for price to leave that high volume area, there has to be a change in perceived value of a large number of participants, because otherwise it wouldn't leave. They'd fade it when it hit the extremes of the D. And when they don't fade it and it breaks higher or lower, that tells you there's a change in perceived value. And if you come into that with some volume analysis, it can tell you how much gusto is behind it. And so I asked the question, did you see any Ds in the last chart? And I went back and I cheated it for you, and we spotted a D there. The next shape is a B, and you get a B shape typically when the market sells off and then consolidates, and this is associated with long liquidation. Basically, what you have is you have a sell-off, and then the market will consolidate in a range, and it'll form somewhat of a B. Let me see if I can find one of those on that chart. Not really seeing one there. We have a P there. I probably have one for you up ahead. Protracted sell-offs often begin with long liquidation that is followed by new sellers entering to follow it up. And so if you do not get this, and usually you don't, then the market will retrace the B. And so Bs, textbook answer, Bs are most often retraced. And so let me talk about that a little more in depth, because I don't want to just blast over that subject, because this is also very key. Most reversals in price start with, if you sell down, for example, this starts with short covering. It's the shorts getting out of their positions. They go, holy moly, it's turning around, I'm getting out. You know, I don't want to go back to a break even on this trade, right? And so that will propel the market higher in this particular example. And so what happens is one of two things. Either the shorts covering will be followed by new longs propelling the market higher, or it'll get faded and new shorts will enter again. But almost invariably, a move begins with either short covering or long liquidation. And so you want to discern between, this is a discerning between old money and new money. Old money is the already existing shorts, or in the example that we're using here, and new money is new positions being established. And I think we'll talk about that a little bit more as we go on. The next shape is a P, and you typically get a P shape when the market rallies and then consolidates. This is opposite to what we just discussed with the B. This is associated with short covering. And protracted rallies often begin with short covering that is followed by new buyers. I might have just told you that other one backwards, but I think you get the idea. Protracted rallies often begin with short covering that is following new buyers entering, following it up. But you don't usually get this follow-up because markets are counter-trend oriented. So what will happen is you'll come up to the P, you'll consolidate a little bit, and then you'll get retraced. So P's are most often reshaped when you see that shape of a distribution on your distribution software, whatever you happen to be using. So sometimes you'll get P's or B's that are backwards. You'll get consolidation followed by the move instead of the other way around. And I don't want to launch into a long discussion of that, but I'm just opening up your thinking about what how different shapes might actually have different kinds of patterning behind them, so going deeper into the kind of thinking. And you will do well to notice when this is occurring. I'm not going to cover that in this lecture, though. Sometimes the move is a gap followed by a consolidation, and then you get a P or a B, but it's missing the volume area, the stem of the P or the B, because it happened overnight. And so that's another pattern that is good to know. So very often gaps are examples of this. You look for clusters of volume following a gap that is followed by a reversal. I think we saw something like that this morning. The B shape, capital B, is associated with continuation. And this is a double distribution. It's kind of like a D with a little punch right in the middle of it. And so it's like putting two D's together, one over the other. And so I mentioned that again. This is another way of expanding your thinking, because everything can really be reduced to a D in some form or another. It's a D with a stem, or it's two D's. You know, so everything reduces to the D, right? And what's a D? It's a normal distribution. It's agreed upon pricing. And so what happens is the market tries to find value, followed by a move that's going to look like a bull or a bear flag, and then it's going to consolidate again. Sometimes you'll have days that look like a rally day. The market, you know, the S&P will move 20 points, and you'll see essentially three D's on there. On the distribution for the day. And the reason for that is it shoots up, it flags out, forms a D, shoots up again, flags out, forms another D, shoots up again, flags out, forms another D, and then there's no time left in the day and you end up with a triple distribution. I very rarely would see that go to four inside of a day. But sometimes you'll see this. And this is an intraday making of the other more basic patterns or shapes. So there are less than one-day profiles. So you could, I know some people developing software that enables you to see these distributions inside of any box that you make on your chart. I had thought about doing this at one time, but then I came up with some other tools that made it simpler for me. There are really only two or one shape, the Ds, and price movements, and everything else can be analyzed from this viewpoint. So this goes hand in hand with the saying, calm before the storm. The D is the calm, and then the storm is when you leave that region. And as I said, if there's a D is agreed upon price and you come to the extremity of the D, you're most likely to get pushed back down into the center of that D, which is, as we discussed initially, the point of control. And in a lot of ways, the market is like Newton's theory of motion. You know, once you set it in motion, it'll continue moving. And then when it hits these areas, people will go, well, wait a minute, it's not worth that anymore. And they'll start getting more and more people agreeing that it should go back the other way. And then you get a pivot. And so markets tend to move, as mentioned, from areas of value through areas of no value quickly. Can you see how that reduces? I just described going from D to D to D. And when we get these quick movements, we call them single prints. This is where you just get one bar going up, and then it clusters. And by the way, when you get that one bar going up, that's low volume, right? And so it can move back through those relatively quickly very often. That can be a trap, bull trap or bear trap. Single prints are when the market moves through an area quickly and leaves a thin profile. Remember, areas of low volume should provide rejection and areas of high volume acceptance. You could even call a high volume area a magnet and a low volume area as a detractor or something that pushes price away. Value area relationships. You then get into value area from one day to the next could be higher or lower or overlapping. And in the reports that I do daily that I'll show you what site those are on, I talk about that inside the report because this can be used as a trend indicator. If you have value areas going progressively higher, sometimes they even gap away like they did yesterday. The whole value area is gapped away from the previous day. They can also be narrower or wider. And so when you have a really narrow distribution, you know, if you get a D and it's really narrow, you're talking about consolidation that's very tight, and you break out from those ranges more easily than you do a wider one. In fact, when you get wider areas, it tends to be more of a market that's ranging and just freely auctioning, and you get these wide value areas. And so you get that kind of a tendency. And I don't think I really talk about that much more, but I do talk about it in the report. And that, like I said, that's the learning aid that continues after this webinar, which is kind of cool. Composites. So far we've been looking at value on a day-by-day basis. We can discern a bigger picture by making composites. Composites are when we join multiple days of volume into one profile. So this makes it easier to see the high volume and the low volume nodes that we talked about initially that can be attractors or detractors, as the case may be, of price action. And this is an example of a composite. And as I had mentioned, this might be the same chart. Yeah, we gap through this low volume area. We open that day into higher area, and then we take our time kind of drifting through that for a couple of days. We make our way lower. We test into a low volume node, and then we come back up right into that value area again. So this is kind of a what we have a stem and a B here, and then it breaks lower, another stem and a little bit of a B. And then we finally retrace. That one, of course, failed. But I had mentioned, you know, you kind of need to know what's going on with the news with all this stuff. You know, 10 years ago, I would have said, oh, I never look at news. And then nowadays, the whole economy is driven by the government. And so you really kind of need to know what's going on the news front, particularly scheduled government reports. Composites are great for doing support and resistance work that provide a larger contextualization of market action. And we always want to trade on a level lower than our lowest level of analysis. This is a interesting principle. We always want to trade on a lower level than our lowest level of analysis. So I want to be trading, you know, 3-minute charts when I'm doing analysis on day charts, for example. I'm just throwing that out there, not necessarily any magic there, but composites are part of this. So I always know what's going on. I always have a composite on my screen because it reminds me of where I am in a bigger picture. one of the problems that we get into as intraday traders is we get so caught up in the minutiae. You know, you find yourself trading on a 3-minute chart intraday, and the range over the last hour has been 1 point, and you're in there trying to take something out of it. And geez, what a formula for getting eaten up, you know, as many of you may be nodding your heads. So I keep these shots on my screen to kind of remind me of what these ranges are and everything else, because I tend to, for just my own personal trading, I tend to trade very tight, very quick. I want action now and I want out. And so that's just my personality. And so others are more patient and can get in a trend trade, you know, day like yesterday, could pick up, you know, 15, 20 points. That'll never happen to me, at least not the way I trade right now. You know, I see it, but I don't do it because I can't stand to sit there. I want to be done by 8:30 in the morning my time and start trading at 6:30. So, you know, as I get older, I don't have the energy and other things. So you find what works for you within these contexts. So you're trading, you know, you're looking at 30-minute charts. I even have 720-minute charts I look at. 1440 is a whole day, 720, 360, then I go to 250, 50-minute chart, 25, 10-minute charts, 5-minute charts, 2-minute charts. And so I have ways of reducing that all down onto one screen, but, you know, trying to keep myself in that larger context so I don't do stupid stuff, you know. Okay, what did you notice from the composite? First off, you should have immediately noticed the high and low volume areas. And then did you see we had formed some value at or about the current level? And let me see what that might have been. Yeah, we're forming value in this current level. This is the high volume node on the chart, but this is a secondary one for sure. And we've definitely, over the last number of days, been working on that region. I think then we broke. We're at 766 now, so we're actually back. We came back down and visited this high volume area, and then we bounced off of that yesterday at the low. We actually came right down through this high volume a little bit, and then we bounced back up. I apologize if that wasn't a bit more current, but we had some time getting the webinar prepared for you, etc. So, and so these numbers are probably not going to be right, but I think we've kind of covered that. Here you can see on this particular composite, and this is from a number of months ago, you know, we get all this clustering in the high volume area. We came down very quickly through that low volume area, and then we clustered at the high volume area, and then, bam, we go really quickly through the low volume area again. So when I'm trading intraday, I'm asking myself the same question. We were looking at this on, you know, multi-day scale. We're looking at it on day scale. I'm asking myself intraday, as the price is clustering after making a move or something, whether or not I have low volume. You know, if we came up into the cluster area, I'm asking myself if we have low volume below it that we can quickly move through. Because when that breaks, I want to be in that trade where it has the potential for moving quickly. Otherwise, it clusters there and you don't get the movement. So I have a blog, markettradersjournal.com, and I do this value area report on there each day for you. And the reason I put that there is as a learning tool, because it covers everything that we're talking about here. I talk about the shape, I talk about the width, I talk about whether it's going higher or lower, whether the value areas are trending. I talk about what the value areas are. I talk about things such as virgin points of control, which we didn't talk about in this webinar. A virgin point of control is kind of like a gap. It's a point of control where the price departed from it. And very often, these are magnet prices later on. And the price will move back into that. And so there are many articles. Over the last 8 months, I've probably written 50 articles on all different kinds of topics on that blog. And I've really poured a lot of my heart and soul into it. And there's I went on vacation a few weeks ago, and I came back, and I just couldn't even begin to muster the kind of energy that I was putting into it before. I I may be able to, you know, come back to that level. But I was writing pretty much every day, and different things, and working on different subjects. But they're there for your reading, and it covers a broad overview of using different kinds of volume techniques and auction techniques. And so, so you can read the articles. There's more there on this same, actually quite a bit, because this is really been a big topic for me, what this webinar is on. And so there's a lot more material there, talking about little nuances and whatnot of using this. I think in a lot of ways it's easy to get trapped into over-analysis, and that's why I talked about that at the beginning. This stuff really shouldn't be that complicated. For me, I've devoted my life to coding systems and analyzing things and writing things about it. And for somebody just coming into this and learning these things in the simplest possible way, like I try to present, then you don't carry all this extra baggage that when you're entering a trade that you carry with you. And so there's really a lot of advantages to coming into this fairly fresh and having somebody to have gone over some of this with you. But I see there are some followings of this sort of thing that just get, I mean, it almost gets like, you know, religious kind of appeal to it. And I try to not hit it at that level, so just try to turn it into the statistical thing that it is. I have a background in experimental design and statistics, so it's natural for me. When I first saw this, I was like, well, wait, this is just statistics in applied statistics. So after reading and studying on the blog or going over this webinar, Mike's recording this, which is really nice. If you have any questions, by all means, ask me. I've put a forum on the blog there. And so if you have any specific questions, or you can ask it within Mike's, we'll try and get some answers on there for you if you post there. I also have a Twitter feed. And I post some of these things on that during the day. I have that kind of automated.
We have a lot
That's what I have.
Great. We have a lot of questions coming in as well.
Okay. I hope I hadn't gone too much. It's come in a pretty good time. So, yeah, I'd be happy to answer any questions. And, Mike, I think you were going to read them. Or
yeah, I will. So, okay. First of all, thanks for the presentation. If anybody has questions, go ahead and start typing them. I'm going to ask several of my own, and also go back and ask what people have been asking as you've been presenting. So first of all, I wanted to clarify, you seem to be focusing solely on volume profile. What about market profile and TPOs? How do you distinguish, or what is your opinion of the, you know, value area that's generated off of TPOs and market profile versus the value area on just volume profile?
Yeah, the TPOs are good, but I found that the, just from my own personal experience, that the volume is really more, it's more true for me. But I also will say this, Mike, and this is why I, you know, after coding systems for a million years and getting into the computer code and everything, I understand this is just a statistical profiling technique. And so the TPO measure will often be very coincidental with the volume profile. Sometimes they vary a bit. But by and large, the volume is really the actual trading that occurred, whereas the TPOs are time at price. So if it clusters in a region for quite a bit of time, you'll get a lot of accumulation there, and you'll get a similar profile. But very often, the volume and the time end up being the same. And so I've just, for whatever reason, settled on volume.
And I noticed that you make extensive use of composite profiles. How are you establishing your start date? Are you looking at a swing high or low, or is your composite only what was on screen, or what are you using?
Typically I will look first try to look through one cycle. But I've even become pretty lax in the way I use that, and I might pull up different numbers of days, but I try to have a minimum of one cycle on there. So just looking at my Russell chart, I might try to go back at least to the 12th or so.
What are you calling a cycle?
On the 12th.
You're calling it a swing high or low?
Yeah, essentially a sine wave. And so you start, you go down to a low, you come up to a high, and then you come back down. That.
Okay.
So I try to have one full cycle in there at a minimum.
And all of your profile now, your volume analysis is based on daily volume?
It's intraday volume, and then that gets compiled into the composites or the.
And are you looking at only regular trading hour cash, or are you looking at Globex overnight?
I do only look. I actually trade the Russell because I like the 10 tick structure, because it's better for the kind of scalping that I do, because the Russell's really spotty at night. I do my composites just on the day data, and I used to run, before I kind of went fully to the Russell, I did use some overnight data. I would run both overnight charts and day charts on the ES.
Okay, and just going back for just a moment to the composite, so did I understand right that you're only looking at, let's say, on average, maybe 2 weeks at a time?
Yeah, maybe a couple weeks, but I will do longer term. I have profiles. I'll put up a 405-minute chart, and I'll do a profile going back over a year, particularly when we get to the extremes. And I didn't actually talk about this subject, but what happens with these profiles is when you start getting near a year high or a year low or something like this, you really don't have any profile to work with unless you want to go back like 5 years. Well, you know, you're going through, you know, 8 contract rolls, and you're compiling data from different contracts. And then, you know, I see guys using, you know, making composites that go back years. And I have to, as a statistician, I have to seriously question the validity of pulling data from, you know, 3 contracts ago, 4 or 5 contracts ago,
right,
and make a composite out of it. But you, I'm sorry, just one other thing. If this is the way you trade, you have to do something, right? So you use what you got.
Right. I do trade this way, by the way.
Yeah,
so
if you don't, if you're at the extremes of price, yeah.
That's why I have all these questions for you. So I'm one of the people that use quite often a multi-year composite. I use IQFee with back adjusted data.
Yeah.
And so it back adjusts the price that's shown on my screen is not the price that it actually traded at, but it is relative to the back adjustment for the contracts so that the levels stay relative.
Exactly. And those levels are particular. So you use like RT or?
I use RT? No, I use Sierra Chart.
Oh, okay. As you get to the extremes of the range over the last N contracts or so, there's really no alternative. And sometimes when we break, you know, higher as we did, number of months ago, it was back in, July. That's strange. Even the beginning of this month, we had broken higher for a while there. We had a big rally around the 4th or so. You know, and then you have to start looking back, you know, 6 or 8 months on your profile to pull some data. There have been cases like in the beginning of 2012 where you would have had to pull back going back close to 2 years.
Right.
In order to get anything. Yeah.
So one more thing on that, since it's relevant, what is your thought process on using tick data, one tick resolution to build a composite? You know, a lot of people don't have access to multiple years of tick data versus using 1 minute. What is your opinion?
I'm a purist in many ways, but then I start realizing it's just a statistical profile, you know. And so in a lot of ways, I think, you know, though I respect and honor doing it right, because that's the right way to do it, I don't know that you really get, you know, it's like the law of diminishing returns. You know, you're putting a lot of effort into something that may not actually be an advantage.
Right.
And so that's what I also talked at the beginning about the whole intuitive thing, because the trading, it really comes down to kind of analyzing what's happening in the picture, and often that could just be something as simple as how fast the ticks are occurring on your screen or something, something that you don't even know that you're doing, you know. And so,
right.
But I agree that, like, the way Gomi has done it on your site, I'd looked at his stuff, and it's great. You know, it's great, and those ladders and everything that's on there, he did it right with the recorder and all that kind of stuff.
So let me.
That's
okay. So before we start talking about footprint, let me go back, and I noticed you didn't mention anything to do with initial balance. Do you use the 1 hour initial balance in any of your trading?
I do. I have it pop up on my screen at 7:30 my time. That'd be 10:30 your time. And essentially, I'm using that in a similar way to the way I use the profiles. I just didn't talk about it because it's not really volume-based. It's just range-based over the first hour. And then I keep on my screen, I've coded some things up. I have average daily range. I have range today. I have initial balance range today, initial balance range average 5 days, average 10 days, so I can see if it's expanding or contracting. Like today on the Russell, we had a IBP range of 7.9, and that's a bit larger than average, and usually when I see that bigger range, I'm going to expect that we're going to be ranging more, as opposed to getting a consolidated, you know, my average 5 day
right.
IBP is 6.8 and I get 3.6, I'm going to be looking for a breakout.
So let me ask some more specific questions. Let's say that, okay, before I ask this, I need to define something. So do you look at balance and imbalance? And like, I typically find that the market will balance itself for, you know, say 2 or 3 days. I primarily trade the ES. And then once we leave that consolidation area, that balance area, we will trend for maybe, you know, 2 days. So I tend to group profiles, build a micro composite profile across, you know, the areas where it was balanced. And I look to see if we open up outside of that value. And I heard that you say, you know, opening out of value. What are you using to define value? Are you using it just the prior day, or are you looking at, you know, 2 or 3 days that are imbalanced?
Yeah, you're actually giving me goosebumps, Mike, because this, what you just described, is a really, if you have the patience, I'm like a bit of an adrenaline junkie or something, but what I look for, what I like to see, is exactly what you described, a couple days of D-distributions. And if that second D is inside the first one, that's even better, you know. Of course, a lot of times when these scenarios that you describe occur, it actually, the action occurs overnight, you know, and then you're like, well, I don't want to sell, you know, 14 handles lower off the open. You know, I don't have intestinal fortitude to do that. But
that actually,
I will look. I've actually learned, I look at my profile charts, not just as individual days. Like, for example, the one I'm looking at today, we have an inside day today. We have a very peaky type of a D distribution that is inside yesterday's kind of B-ish shape. But we're even kind of down into the D part of that B-ish shape from yesterday. We couldn't really get up above the value area high from yesterday. And so we really kind of have, if I omit the stem of that B from yesterday, I have an inside D inside double D. And so this is exactly what I'm looking at my chart here is pretty much what you just described. Even though yesterday was not a consolidation day, actually the latter part of the day was. And right. So, but I'm discerning that just by looking at my profile chart and not trying to use any software to do it. I'm just looking at it and saying, Monday afternoon, though it pushed lower, it went and it caught this, I'm looking at the Russell, by the way, but we came down and we touched this high volume node on the composite. We actually went through it a little bit, and then we came back up, but it was also a virgin point of control from quite a while ago, and then it bounced back off of that and consolidated, and then we consolidated today. So, like, if I see us going on the Russell tomorrow, you know, much above, we have a pretty tight value area today. So if I see us, you know, blasting through 768 half on any kind of volume or something, I'm going to look to catch something going long tomorrow. So, you know, depending on the report. So I like the Forex site for the, I forget which one it is.
Forex Factory has a good news calendar.
Yeah, they got it. Yeah, I really like theirs because you can learn what the reports are about. It describes each one and it tells how it's computed and
right. So let me go back to the second part of the question. So if you define value and kind of like a microcomposite of when the market is balanced versus unbalanced, let's say that for the last 3 days we've been balanced and today we open up outside of value to the long side. What is your thought process? Are you biased towards longs? Are you a counter trend, you know, mean reversion kind of guy? What's going through your head on a scenario like this where we've been in balance, today we opened up outside of value? What do you do?
Yeah, if we've been consolidating for a day and a half, as in this conversation that we're having, and we break higher on the open, we break out of value on the open, I'm going to try to bias myself as a trend trader, at least initially.
Okay.
And I'll want to see some volume with that.
Okay.
But.
And I agree with you. I mean, I think that that's one of the hardest things that I found people have trouble doing is because they feel like it should revert back. They seem to discount or disregard that there are trending days. While they're not as often as their, you know, balance days or range bound days, they do happen.
Yeah, it's really impossible. It's, you know, there's no other word for it than damned if you do and damned if you don't. And nothing's worse than fading a rally day.
So
you just get killed,
right.
Killed.
So that brings me
time that you would have made a ton of money on the trade.
Yeah, that brings me to the next question, and that's actually a good point. You know, I see people get killed on tight range days because they're trading the extremes and they seem to be caught in the wrong direction every single time. And then I see people get killed on trend days because they were just trying to counter trend it the entire day and that it's never they never made a single trade in the right direction. So you've got to have the right tools for both kinds of days. So I noticed that on your charts, it seems that you don't use what I call extensions. So you're not extending like a naked extension of the value area or a naked extension of the point of control. I typically use those as support and resistance. Do you not do that?
Are you using a multiple of the value area range?
Yeah, I take the value area high and low, and I will extend those lines forward until price hits that again. And if it doesn't hit it, then it remains on my chart until it does. Same thing with the point of control.
I actually do that with the IBP. I use multiples of IBP. But I've never done that.
Okay,
with,
not
the
sorry, area. Sorry, not multiples. I'm talking about, let's say that today we have the value area high. I will extend that line forward, and it will remain on my chart. That line will stay on my chart forward. It's an extension until price returns to that level. Once price trades at that level, the line will be taken out.
Oh, okay. I do that with virgin points.
Right, yeah, virgin point of control is another way to describe it.
Yeah, and I had my guys code it so that it'll keep the line on there indefinitely until it gets hit.
Okay, so we're talking about the same thing. So you do
yeah, we
you
are.
Do that.
We are.
Okay.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay,
And those are extremely important areas. I didn't spend a lot of time on that in the webinar, but Virgin points of control are huge.
So then this goes to the next...
particularly where they're piling up. Yeah, okay.
Sorry, this goes to the next question. So if you have these lines in your chart, my question is, how are you trading them? I'm trying to get a sense for, do you, long, let's go back to that scenario where we've been balanced, now we open outside of value to the upside, so you're positioned, you know, you're thinking long. Do you long and look for, you know, the next area of resistance, maybe as a prior value area low or a prior point of control? Do you trade that, or do you put your trades in ahead of time to counter trend off of that move that you might be expecting for the market to bounce back?
For my personal trading, what I'm really doing, I more or less depart from all of this when it comes to the actual trading. But let me clarify that. It's not because it doesn't work, because I've spent untold numbers of hours sitting here watching this stuff all day long forever. But because my personal trading is much shorter in its duration, and so I'm really using all this as a much larger context. And so I come to the conviction that the market's doing, you know, such and such, it's going higher or it's going lower. And then I try to look for my little breakout scenario within that on a very, very tight stop, usually about a point. There's a 1-point stop, and which a lot of times I kick myself for because it's probably too tight sometimes, but I trade more size, and so it just manages to work for me. But I believe that if you have the patience to trade longer like that, that is a very valid approach. And there are certainly enough people doing it that it can become a self-fulfilling prophecy to price movement, and you can be with that group that's doing that, because we know that big money trades this.
Right. You
know. Yeah.
Okay. I see several questions that we're talking about the composite profiles. So I think that in your presentation that you mentioned that high volume composite or high volume node is like a magnet. Price is drawn to it because there's a greater agreement of value. Am I right?
Right.
Okay. And then you're saying that low volume almost acts as the exact opposite, because there was no agreement. There was the opposite.
And yeah. So it has less stopping power is probably a good way to put it.
Okay, so you find that as price, let me ask you the question, let me set it up. If price, if we're in a trending day and we're trending towards a low volume node, what do you do? Do you pay it? How does that line in the sand come into play for you?
What I would do is I would look on my chart for a breakout kind of a scenario. And I would try to trade a break into that region with a relatively tight stop in hopes that it would have no stopping power.
Okay, so you're looking for price to trade straight through it and keep going.
Yeah, that's what I want.
Okay. And I see a question. Sorry. I see questions here about the point of control. So let me just ask you. I don't want to give my opinion. I want to hear yours. Do you view point of control as maybe I should reframe this. Let's say that we have yesterday's point of control on our chart for today. What does that line mean to you? Is that a resistance? Is it support? Is it an area price is drawn to? What is it?
Yeah, if we had no reports today and we opened up inside of value, I would expect a revisit to the point of control. Even if we opened like at the value area high or value area low, I'm going to expect to come back and visit that point.
Okay.
So that's I expect that to be a magnet price.
Okay.
If we open out of value, I'm going to expect that if we come to that point, we're going to if we opened above and we come back down to that point of control, I'm going to expect that we're going to trade higher from there.
Okay. I'm in complete agreement with you. So
yeah, so it'll act as support if it opens higher. It'll act as resistance if it opens lower.
Right. Now, since, you know, the majority of our days are range days, what's your play? What's your mentality? Are you looking to fade extremes? Let's say that you see like a B or a P profile. Are you trying to fade it? Are you trying to do the opposite and build a position early in the day and hold for the extreme? What's your thought process?
Yeah. It's funny, Mike, because I was solely a counter trend trader for 15 years. I wouldn't do anything unless it was like a high or a low, you know, or pretty darn close to it. And more recently, I almost have, and I'm only saying this because you're asking the question and I'm reflecting, not because I'm have given it thought, but I've really become an intraday trend trader. But I'm catching a counter trend within that larger trend. And so that fills my need of being, you know, a deal shopper, you know.
Well, what I find, and I'm just trying to get your input so that, you know, not everyone is always listening to me all the time, but I find that a lot of people on the forum have a, you know, built-in tendency to counter trend, right? And they see a market trading at an extreme or what they perceive to be an extreme, and they typically want to short it, or they want to, you know, reverse away, and they're a reversion to the mean type of a trader. And what I find happens in a lot of those scenarios, though, is that we'll end up with a P or a B-shaped curve, and price will trade to the extreme, and then it will sit there and consolidate for the rest of the day. And then very likely the next day will be the break outside of value and then the trend. So it doesn't work, you know. Now,
yeah, you're always out of phase with what you need to be doing. This is where, and I didn't discuss it in this webinar, and maybe we'll do one in the future where we simply talk about looking at what I call net ticks, or the sum of net ticks, because if you're at a high for the day, like this morning on the open, for that first 30 minutes we didn't have any reports. And so what we did was we came up and we tested the Globex high. There was no new information in the system. And so we tested the Globex high. There was no new information in the system. And as I recall, the volume wasn't pushing any let me pull it up here so I know my – actually, we did get a good push, but by the time the report came out, the volume was actually breaking below it, where it was from the open, and the price was lower too. So now I missed that, and I ended up taking two little scalps today and didn't do anything, but I also recognized that I was really kind of out of it today. And so I'll stop myself from trading if I feel that I'm out of it, because on the open you got to be really sharp.
Right.
But what I was getting at is, I'm contextualizing the question. You come up to a new high. It's at the Globex high. There's no new information in the system, and the volume starts to fade. And so to me, that's a setup for a counter trend trade.
Okay. So going back to what you said in your presentation, you said one of the very first things that you do is look to see if we've opened in or out of value. And I do that as well. So what's the next step? What do you know, I'm just trying to have you walk us through a day to where, how are you framing the market? How are you deciding? Or do you decide today is likely to be a range day, today is likely to be a trend day, and I have certain game plans for certain kinds of days?
Yeah, when we opened this morning, we were opening inside of value following that range day from yesterday. And so I expected that we were going to range trade today. And but I also knew that we had a report coming out 30 minutes after, and that was actually a disappointing report. So that was a catalyst to push the market to test a low. But my thought this morning was just quite simply this. We open in range, I expect range trading. You know, we open out of range, I expect Now, yesterday morning, not today, but yesterday morning, we actually opened above value and then immediately traded right back through it and then headed south most of the day.
Right.
But there was also a negative report that came out 30 minutes after. I don't remember which time that report was right offhand. But we opened above value. We had a bad report.
How often do you find that we open outside of value and we end up consolidating back into the range? We fall backwards.
Actually, you know, that's a great question because I think it happens way more often than the market auction people would like to admit.
Right.
It just doesn't hold up that well. So then you start talking about looking at it in terms of failures. Like I said, yesterday we open above value, we have a bad report, we immediately go through the entire value area and head south the rest of the day.
Right. So do you have a process of saying, you know, today we've opened outside of value, but, you know, there's not a lot of strength here. Are you looking at initial balance to help you decide that we're likely to fall back?
Yeah, I'm actually relying at that point on an intuitive process. And yesterday I did catch, I kind of have to answer the question on a day-by-day basis because I'm really very intuitive at this point. I caught a short off of the open, and I picked up 4 points on that yesterday. And then when it clustered in the third to fourth half hour or so, I made the mistake, because we were at the value area low, right? That was about 8:30 my time, it's 11:30 your time approximately. I caught a long there, and I got taken out. And then I sold again, and I made back what I had lost, and I decided I'm taking the rest of the day off. So, but that was my process yesterday.
Right.
So it's always where are we in terms of value, and what are the reports doing? And what kind of expectation do I think that report has? Like, for example, today we didn't meet the new home sales number, and I actually would have thought that would be much more bearish than it was.
Right.
So I'm kind of thinking down tomorrow.
And someone had asked this question. They're talking about the 80% rule. And if I remember this correctly, it's something along the lines where 80% of the time, if we open outside of value, then it'll fill the value area or something like that.
You know,
it's
what?
Been a while.
I wouldn't doubt, Mike, that that's probably pretty close. It'd be interesting to set up a test. I don't have software to give me that I can access those values and code it, because I would run tests on that sort of thing. Years ago, I wouldn't have been able to stop myself from coding that and testing it, but
right.
I bet you're right, and that's exactly the opposite of what's, you know, supposedly going to be the case. So, you know.
So let me ask just a couple of more generic questions, and then also, if anybody has asked a question that I have not already answered, type it again, please. So here's just a couple of generic questions. Do you, regarding your own personal trading and not necessarily regarding profile or volume, do you always have a certain risk reward in mind? Will you trade if the risk reward is not at least 1-to-1? Do you look at those kinds of things before you trade?
I do, and I'm not as I've reduced it to this, Mike, and I kind of chuckle at myself, and I call it chicken, you know, blank, 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 blank trading. But here's what I do. I found this works for me. It might not be for you, but this is what works for me. I have my little way of finding my spots for entry. I have basically a 1-point stop. I trade either a 3-lot or a 5-lot in the Russell. Now, the Russell can move a point as faster as you can click the darn buttons, you know. And so what I do on the 5-lot is I immediately take either 2 or 3 of them off at about 4 or 5 ticks. And then I move my stop to, because I have this entry down. And so, and that's why I'm, maybe I don't mean to sound evasive in how I answer some of these questions, but I have it reduced to zero risk entry approach for Rob, you know. And so I take those two or three off, depending on how much momentum I'm getting, and then I immediately move the remaining two or three to what would be a break even or enough to pay for my commission or whatever, and then I try to let it ride. And okay. if I do a 5-3 and leave two remaining, and we get to some sort of if we hit a virgin point or something like that, I'm probably taking the other one of the two remaining off, okay. And try to let the other run.
So it sounds like you're all in, scale out.
All in, scale out. I find that scaling in as it goes with you, I can't stand losing it back. You know, I'm like, wow, I had a successful trade and I got greedy and lost it all back. So that's never worked for me. I'm all in and scale out.
That's okay. I see a question. What time frame charts are you trading from? So I know that you mentioned that you have a bunch of charts up. What I would call an entry chart, a chart that you always use to set up your exact entry?
Yeah, my charts, almost all of them are 3-minute charts. I have my market profile charts are 30-minute charts is the standard rule. On the real long-term ones, I'll use a 405-minute for the ES, for example. I use a 3-minute chart with a bunch of moving averages on it that represent longer time frames. And you can set that up in NinjaTrader by the time frame, but I've done a lot of studies on that and found that there's really no particular advantage to that. So you just throw various moving averages on it, so you get kind of like a rainbow on the chart. And that reminds me of what the longer term trend might be doing. And then I have a 1,000 volume chart, and I particularly like that for dealing with the overnight price action. That's on the Russell, by the way. In the ES, would be a 10,000 volume. But it lets me see the overnight price action in usually just a couple bars.
Right.
So I can see the bigger picture on that. And then I've got a 3-minute, and then I have a certain kind of breakout patterns, and I have I have a 1,000 volume, a 3-minute, and a 1-minute. And those are usually the charts that I'm keying my entries off of, along with my volume chart.
Okay.
And what I use on the volume chart, and like I said, okay, go ahead.
Sorry, so you primarily trade the Russell. Do you believe that the volume profile or this type of volume analysis works on any market? Does it work on stocks? Does it work on currencies? In particular with Forex, since you don't have a centralized market, do you still think that it works on futures currencies?
If I were trading Forex through a service for Forex, I would probably keep up futures charts and use the volume there. As opposed to using TPOs on Forex charts. I've never traded Forex because I have a inherent distrust of the pricing on that, but I know people who do. I know people who swear up and down you should trade Forex in the futures market, not on the, you know, these other interbank services that are available, but... and I'm talking about the more liquid ones like the euro and the yen, for example. But yes, I do believe that this works in any market, and I say that simply on the basis that it's a statistical distribution of an auction. And so it has to work to the degree that this stuff works. You know, to me, that's why I said context, context, context. It's a context, and I try to completely understand it and then kind of like throw it out. And so that when I'm actually trading, I'm not going, is it, if you're above value, it's this, and, you know.
Sure, absolutely.
I kind of look at, okay, where are we opening, and okay, we're kind of in this thing. Oh, yeah, this seems to be, what I thought was happening seems to be manifesting. I'm going to go with
it. Yeah, context is king. This is why I always tell everybody there's no such thing as black and white in trading. Everyone's always looking for, if this happens, then here's the here's what I'm going to do. And that's just, that's called a holy grail. It doesn't exist.
Yeah. And you're right, Mike. And I coded systems for 15 years and I refuse. I have this motto, if you can't code it, it doesn't exist. And I held true to that. And I've gone through so many alternations of systems just doing incredibly well and then failing. Not that they fail, because they wax and wane, you know. The system works for a while, and your emotions go up and down with it. And I was like, I want something more consistent. And that's when I really started looking at this profiling technique and setting up a context and trying to trade within it in a way that works for me. Because very often the systems are just unbearable to trade. You know, you get in a trade and you know it's probably not working, but then you go, no, the system's got to do its thing. And you sit there and you watch it. You know, you were up 20 handles on the ES and you get stopped out the next day for 15, you know.
Right.
Oh, my goodness, you know. And then your emotions are going with that. And you're like, wow, my emotions are completely controlled by money. That's not right. You know, I don't want to live like that. And so that's when I started allowing myself to start thinking like what we're talking about in the webinar here. Yeah. It's been very liberating, actually, in a lot of ways.
So in your presentation, you mentioned James Dalton, of course. Do you have any other recommendations for people that are looking to read from, you know, different published books that teach volume profile or just teach auction market theory in general?
You know, I think first I'll qualify, that first Dalton book, Mind Over Markets, is the Bible. I wouldn't read anything before that time. You know, it's kind of funny, and I'll just say this very quickly. When Steidlmeyer came up with this stuff, they didn't know what to do with it. This is really kind of the funny thing about it, because it gets this this big, you know, following and everything. They didn't know what to do with this stuff. And then they later kind of figured, well, it must mean this, you know. And they tried to kind of fit the trading into the box somehow, you know, and it didn't work. There were even, somebody asked me a question the other day, there were services that started up that were trying to track what the big money's doing. And I think Dalton was behind one of these. It's a big service you could subscribe to, it's several hundred a month. And they flopped because they couldn't tell what the other time frame was doing. But anyways, the very Bible to me is Mind Over Markets.
Right.
That book, if you're really going to learn it, that's a big undertaking. you better have your heart in it, or don't bother.
Yeah, it's a tough book to read, man. I just read a new book by John Kepler, and it's not an advanced book, but I think it's perfect for anyone that is just starting out with volume profile, or market profile. He largely talks about market profile, but most of it can be transferred over to volume profile pretty easily.
Sure.
But he does a really, really good job. So my recommendation would be, if you're new to all this, it's a pretty good book that just sets up auction market theory in general and talks about value areas and points of control and the different types of distributions and all that. But it's not an advanced book.
Mike, I don't know what your thought is on this, but, you know, Dalton's second book, Markets in Profile, which is actually supposed to be a more advanced book, is actually pretty easy to read too. I don't know if you've read that one, but that's you probably shouldn't go there until you get some of the basics down. So maybe this one that you just mentioned.
Yeah,
there's a ton of stuff on my blog on this subject. I just started writing, and I, you know, 50 articles later. You know, for anybody who writes, Mike, I know you know what I'm talking about. You know, you write an article, you have eight hours into writing a nice article, you know.
Right.
So there's a lot of material there. Those are definitely what I would consider the better books on this subject.
Okay. So I think this is a good time to wrap it up. I see a couple people asking on that book I just mentioned. It's John Kepler, K-E-P-P-L-E-R, and it's called Profit with Market Profile. It's a good beginner's book. All right, so if anybody has any further questions, then they can reach you on your website or send you an email, right? What was that info again?
Oh, it's rob@markettradersjournal.com.
And then, so your website is also markettradersjournal.com?
Yeah, and that site was just, you know, like I said, you know, somebody said, you know, if you have a subject you really love, you can write a blog on it, but make sure you love it or you'll never be able to follow through with it. And so I just started that. My wife had an extra site on the thing that she has, and we threw that together, and it's grown into, yeah, I'm pretty pleased with it. But there's like I said, there's just a ton of articles there, and you know, if you have questions, and you know, by all means, I'm always answer. Right. But ask through the discuss thing on there. That way, other people can read it too. You know?
Okay. And what was your YouTube channel? Is there a link on there from your website?
It's Nindicators YouTube channel. It's Ninja Indicators, contracted into one word, Nindicators.
Okay. And I guess that's probably linked on your website somewhere if people are trying to find that.
You know, interestingly, it's got to be on there somewhere. But what I do is it's a great mini webinar for, you know, just looking at the overnight price action, and I have no preparation for it. I turn on my recorder and I prepare nothing, and I just pull the charts up and talk about them. And so it's just kind of like actually what I'm thinking live right before the open.
Right.
You know,
okay. Great.
You know, for what it's worth. Yeah.
All right. So, Rob, I really appreciate your time today. And, of course, I appreciate Matt for introducing you to BMT. So if anybody has questions that were not answered, you can get a hold of Rob on his website. I also want to remind everybody that the webinar was recorded, and I will post the recording probably sometime tomorrow on BMT.
Hey, Mike, thanks very much for the invite, and I appreciate you giving me the time to talk.
Yeah, same here, Rob. I look forward to having you back again. Thanks, guys.
Okay, thanks.
See everybody on the site.
Take care, everybody.
All right,
bye. Bye-bye.